Hello, as Speaker of the House, it is a joy to join our First Lady, Dr. Jill Biden, colleagues, friends, and guests as we celebrate Women's History Month and honor our nation's extraordinary educators. We'll now begin with the Pledge of Allegiance led by the students at Benjamin Banneker Elementary School in Milford, Delaware. Please stand as you are able.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This year, we are excited to once again mark this annual celebration of Women's History Month with the most diverse House of Representatives in history, with a record-shattering 122 women. Let me salute our bipartisan leadership of the Congressional Caucus for Women's Issues, co-chair Madeline Dean and Jennifer Gonzalez-Colon. This month, we applaud the contributions that women have made to our nation throughout our history. We recognize the great progress that women leaders continue to forge today, and we look to inspire future generations of brave women to build on the progress we have made. While we honor all of our educators every day, this month we take a moment to recognize a profession that is overwhelmingly made up of spectacular women. In that spirit, it is an honor to join First Lady Dr. Jill Biden to highlight the incredible work that she and all of America's educators are doing to lift up our nation's young people. Dr. Biden is a trailblazer for all women and the first First Lady to work full-time while in the White House. Her career as a community college professor, now returning to Northern Virginia Community College, and her dedication to public service is an inspiration to countless women and girls. As a teacher, Dr. Biden understands firsthand the incredible commitment of America's educators to their students. She is dedicated to lifting them up as they ensure that, despite the challenges they face, our children continue to have access to a quality education. Our nation is truly blessed by our wonderful educators, and now it is my distinct privilege to present a teacher and a lifelong champion for education and our children, First Lady Dr. Jill Biden.
Thank you, Speaker Pelosi. Nancy, as minority leader, we have seen how you drove a national conversation and inspired your members. We've seen how you've pushed our nation on bold action and empowered your caucus as Speaker of the House, even when you knew that bills had little chance of being signed. And now, once again, we are seeing just how much you can accomplish when you have partners in the Senate and the White House. Congress was able to pass one of the most transformational bills in generations, just 50 days into this presidency, because of your leadership in the House and the incredible women who serve with you. And that number just keeps growing. As we rebuild our nation better than before, it's the voices of women who are going to lead our way. Nancy, you've made history again and again. So thank you for all that you do. And thank you to all the women with us who dare to step up, speak out, and run. When we think of the forgotten heroes of women's history, I think of the generations of educators, a majority of women, whose work changed the course of our nation, but so often went unseen. We admire the clay pot, but not the many hands that shaped it, the teachers who patiently guided our great minds, the counselors who listened, the bus drivers and cafeteria workers who helped students find confidence, and the school leaders who fought for them. In classrooms at the end of long, dusty farm roads or surrounded by the car horns and screeches of a city, there have been educators quietly creating the future, one person at a time. We've seen it more than ever this last year. In the depths of this pandemic, our families and schools have been tested like never before. And yet, I've never been more proud to be an educator. Just look at what we've done. Teachers changing lesson plans and learning new platforms so that we can teach virtually almost overnight. Administration and staff delivering lunches to families who might go hungry when school cafeterias closed. Bus drivers traveling to neighborhoods with hotspots so kids would have Wi-Fi for class. Counselors taking calls from parents on the verge of tears, overwhelmed by working and overseeing remote learning. No one knows how to take a bad situation and find the opportunity for growth like educators. We do it every day. When the classroom budgets run out, when stressed out children act up, when the lesson plans go wrong, we find a way to push past the chaos and create something beautiful for our students. Today, we are honoring four women from across our country. They teach different subjects and grades. They are focused on racial justice, LGBTQ inclusion, women and girls in STEM, and creating new opportunities even in this pandemic. But they all have one thing in common. With every class they lead, with every mind they change, with every life they impact, they are writing our history and our future too. And that is true for every educator with us today. Right now, someone out there is a better thinker because of you. Someone is standing a little taller because you helped them find the confidence they needed. Someone is working a little harder because you pushed them to try. Someone is kinder because you showed them what that meant. Someone is braver because you helped them find their courage. Student by student, you are writing our history and changing our world. Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker Pelosi, for hosting the event and allowing me to be a part of it, and Dr. Biden for being such an incredible role model for all of our educators. One of the greatest jobs I ever had was being a member of the English department at LaSalle University in Philadelphia for 10 years. I loved teaching composition, writing, legal writing, and ethics. I will never forget the joy of speaking with students every day and learning from them their experiences, their triumphs, and their struggles. I'd love to see young people's minds light up when they claim their own words in their own education. As an educator, you are lucky to be a part of each and every student's education, but the job, of course, comes with its challenges. Our teachers are among the most hardworking Americans there are, yet many feel unappreciated or underappreciated and underpaid. We've been inspired watching our teachers across America try to maintain their classroom as COVID has uprooted our lives. Many educators have done this while also taking care of their own children. Partisanship does not exist in our classrooms. There are only our children. What teachers do every day as they sit at their computer or in their classroom during this strange time is push our children to be more well-rounded and mature every day. We know students spend on average 1,000 hours a year in school, and for their teachers, this is 1,000 hours of excellence in our educators that they are providing our families, our children. We are thankful and reminded why being a teacher is one of the greatest professions, and why it brought me so much joy to be one. I can't imagine having to do all that the educators are doing during this past year, especially with all of the technology, all of the challenges. We are nothing without our teachers and our educators, and we often overlook their contribution to society. If this year teaches us anything, let it be a reminder that for our own sake and for the sake of our children, we need and applaud our teachers.
Hi, I'm Congresswoman Jennifer Gonzalez, the first woman elected to represent the 3.2 million American citizens from Puerto Rico in Congress. I'm also the co-chair of the Bipartisan Women's Caucus, one that looks more like the America we represent, with a historic 123 diverse women serving in the U.S. House. I want to say thank you to Speaker Pelosi for organizing this event, and I'm especially proud to be joining you today as we honor Dr. Jill Biden and women educators from all over the country. As a daughter of two public school teachers, this is very special for me. I'm always grateful to having the opportunity to address leaders of tomorrow and those who are instrumental in steering them towards a successful path. I'm what I am because of my teachers. And without a doubt, the past year has been a challenging one. But for you as teachers has been as resilient as ever in your mission and passion to educate America's students. You have had to create new interactive ways to maintain students engaged during distance learning and doing everything you can to ensure that those children in underserved communities have the resources and the support they need, even when they don't have anyone to assist them at home or even don't have access to digital classrooms. In the case of Puerto Rico, where more than 55% of our children live under the poverty level, many teachers have had to resort to phone applications like WhatsApp to reach students, while others have turned their homes into classrooms. To all of you, I need to say thank you. Although the educational experience has been different, I hope all students continue to learn from you, the influential and powerful women who do not shy away from any challenge and continue to prepare them for the future success. Thank you all for all what you do, and I wish you the best throughout this year, throughout the school years, as we soon hope to put this pandemic behind us. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Congressman Bobby Scott. Every March, we observe Women's History Month to celebrate the outstanding contributions of women leaders to our nation. Over this past year, women across industries have been in the forefront of the nation's fight against the COVID-19 pandemic. This year has been difficult for everyone, but particularly for educators who have been integral to providing stability to our communities despite the challenges of remote learning during the pandemic. As the chair of the Committee on Education and Labor, I've been focused on equity in education. We know that the pandemic has only widened the achievement gaps, but thankfully we have new partners in the Biden-Harris administration, including Dr. Jill Biden, who understand the gravity of the crisis and are committed to equitably responding to the pandemic. The American Rescue Plan provides schools the resources they need to reopen safely and protect students and their staff, and to make up for lost time in the classroom. While physical classrooms have spent much time closed, our teachers have quickly adapted to the entirely new way of teaching our students. The American Rescue Plan also directs urgently needed relief to institutions of higher learning, childcare providers, and our essential workers. We have much to celebrate during this year's Women's History Month, but we have much more work ahead to guarantee equal pay, paid leave, universal child care, access to a union, and reproductive health. I know that thanks to the leadership of women across our nation, including Speaker Pelosi, Dr. Biden, Vice President Harris, and the historic number of women in Congress, we will be able to guarantee a more equitable future for all.
Superwoman. better days to come. And all my women sitting here trying to come home before the sun. And all my sisters coming together, say yes I will, yes I can, 'cause I am a superwoman, yes I am, yes she is. Even when I'm a mess I still put on a vest with an S on my chest, oh yes I'm a superwoman.
Thank you, Speaker Pelosi and Dr. Biden, for honoring these incredible educators as we celebrate Women's History Month. Throughout March, we'll uplift stories of women who have broken barriers, forged new paths, and contributed to the foundation of American education. Celebrating these accomplishments is especially important this year. America's educators, so many of them women, have continued this proud legacy of innovation despite the pandemic's tremendous challenges. I've been moved by the resilience of teachers and school staff and by their creative, compassionate responses in our communities. Their approaches are as varied as the places and people they serve. In some towns, school leaders revised bus routes to ensure rural students had access to in-person learning. In others, teachers delivered meals to students who needed them or found ways to provide extra hours of care and support for children of essential workers. Our educator workforce has not only continued high-quality teaching and learning during the most difficult circumstances, but have gone above and beyond to meet the needs of 21st century students. They introduced students to diverse role models in every field, people who made their mark despite facing incredible odds. Students need experiences that help them to dream big, and this includes encouraging more girls to embark on careers in the STEM fields, where women currently make up only about a quarter of the workforce. Diverse voices and perspectives make us stronger in everything we do. Each day, educators present new possibilities to students so they can discover their life's passion. I think of Linda Ransom, my high school art teacher. She empowered me to develop as a person, encouraged me to pursue teaching, and counseled me to think about elementary education as one of many ways to show students from a very early age, those who look like me and those who didn't, that role models come in every form and that promise of perseverance can open any door. To all the educators who inspire their students in new ways, thank you. To all the students motivated by Women's History Month, aim high. Know that in me and in the historic Biden-Harris administration, you have advocates committed to communication, accountability, transparency, inclusivity, and results. I look forward to emerging from this crisis stronger than ever before. During Women's History Month and throughout the year, we can bring out the best in each other and work toward a bright future.
I'm Congresswoman Johanna Hayes, and I'm thrilled to join the Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi, at her annual Women's History Month celebration. We have to do this virtually this year, but every year, the Speaker uplifts and highlights women from all over the country. It is a tremendous honor this year to celebrate Dr. Jill Biden, a fellow educator and our First Lady. I also would like to join Madam Speaker and the First Lady of the United States to celebrate four extraordinary educators. Teaching is my first love. It is the profession that I gave so much of my life to. I remember my time in the classroom and the joy that my students used to bring me. I remember traveling the country and the world as the 2016 National Teacher of the Year, engaging with educators and learning from what they did on the ground. This year, I could not have been more proud of my colleagues in the teaching profession. We saw as teachers all over the country were the heroes. They transformed their classrooms to virtual learning. They met their students in communities and passed out lunches. They passed out digital devices for their students to engage and worked with families and parents to help them support their children. Teachers were the real heroes, and I am so proud of them and honored to celebrate you. Today, there are four extraordinary educators that are being highlighted that really exemplify all that is good in our profession. I am so honored to join the speaker to work to make sure that we are giving teachers the resources that they need for our students to thrive. Just yesterday, we passed the American Rescue Plan, which really is a lifeline to all of our school districts to make sure that they can reopen safely. It is not lost on us how hard you have worked, and I celebrate you, I commend you, and I thank you for your hard work. This Women's History Month, we celebrate you.
Sarah Miliantalafin, Ms. Millie to my students, and I teach 7th and 8th grade STEM lab at Alima Intermediate and Eva Beach, Hawaii. I'm also the faculty sponsor of the Rainbow Royales, the 2020 GLSEN National Gender Sexuality Alliance, or GSA, of the year. When my students look back at this year, I want them to remember that through it all, we still sparkled and held space for each other. See, in my class, when students get a question right or do an awesome job on a presentation, we give finger sparkles. You can give sparkles to another student, to a team, a whole class, or even yourself to celebrate a job well done. When we started online learning in the fall of 2020, a student that had previously taken one of my courses said, "Miss, how are we supposed to sparkle online?" So like everything this year, we figured it out together. Teaching during this pandemic has been an exercise of problem solving with truth and compassion. We figured out that students with high quality broadband internet could give finger sparkles by turning on their cameras. If you couldn't use your camera, you could unmute and we'd count down and say the word sparkles together. Many chose to type sparkles in the chat box. For multilingual learners or students with special needs, if typing was difficult, they could use emojis to participate and shine. To my LGBTQIA learners, some who have shared that they might not be able to sparkle in rainbow colors where they are right now, I want them to remember that online community is valid and important, and that we're holding your safe space for you at school and in online GSA meetings. And maybe a student joined class and wasn't feeling very sparkly. That was okay too. As a classroom community, we held space for each other to shine, but also reminded one another of past successes and the brighter days ahead. Everyone sparkles in their own way and to their own ability. And together, even during a pandemic, we're still shining.
I am the speech and debate coach at Academy at Palumbo in Philly, and I have the most amazing team, and we've had a lot of success. I qualified a bunch of students to states and nationals at the end of last year and again this year, and it's all because my students are so hardworking. We've had so many challenges throughout the year, starting with my students who qualified to nationals last year. My students had to record their performance, but the problem was because I couldn't be with them with a camera and they couldn't even be with each other in the same room, we had to record it over Zoom. And then what we found out was that both of them had really bad internet connections. And so we'd get like 2 minutes in and one of them would freeze. And so we'd have to start over again. And we'd get like another, 3 minutes in and the other one would freeze. Or like there was at least five times we were there. We were like 10 seconds away. And then one of them would freeze and we'd have to start over again. I got so desperate that I went to a Facebook group that had other speech and debate coaches and said, like, what are you guys doing? How are you overcoming this internet issue? And I had a coach respond to me, oh, you can just buy them some AirPods and a lapel mic or go out and get them a hotel room. I don't even get paid for my, to coach, let alone spend money on like a hotel room in Philly. Yeah, it's like, that's not going to happen. On the internet, if you have a bad internet connection, those judges can't, like, it's hard for them to hear the arguments the students are making. So there's a lot of times I'll get ballots back after a tournament and I'll read it and say, I couldn't understand what you were saying. Your internet connection wasn't very good. You kept on breaking up. And then, so then my students lose because the judge couldn't hear what they were saying. And it's really frustrating because I know they're really good debaters and they have really smart, logical, well thought out things to say. What do I hope that this history book say about this time is that this was the time that America realized, started recognizing the deep inequities that exist and asking the right questions. Like, why is this the way it is?
So what I'm most proud of is that we were able to support a group of students who have been historically excluded from participating in the science and being able to participate in research during the COVID-19 pandemic. Prior to the COVID-19 pandemic, we have been looking into offering remote research opportunities that make it more accessible to students who have financial or cultural obligations at home. And so we wanted to provide opportunities that were designed and tailored for these students in mind so that we could increase participation from people from historically excluded groups. My field, geology, has the lowest rate of racial and ethnic diversity in all the STEM fields. Less than 8% of PhDs are awarded to people who identify as Black, Indigenous, or Latinx. I work with an amazing group of researchers across the country who, like me, have also struggled to find their place in academia. And we work to identify and mitigate social and economic barriers in the geosciences so the next generation of scientists can do their work with their whole authentic selves. I grew up in a community much like the one I'm working in today, a community that struggles with poverty, inequity, and racism. And it can often feel bleak because people struggle to see past the deficits and people tend to overlook the vibrancy and creativity that exists in these communities. And when you make it through, like I have, I've taken my family from illiteracy to the highest achievements in education in four generations. People often focus on the perseverance and sacrifice it took to get there, but they often fail to ask, what could you have accomplished if you didn't have to overcome barriers? My upbringing is not unique, and I don't want my success to be unique either. I want students to have access to opportunities that our parents and grandparents did not have access to. I'm proud to be part of a much needed change in science, that our science reflects our communities. And we'll continue this work until all students have been afforded the same opportunities. Our success is linked. Lifting each other up lifts our communities up.
Greetings and salutations from North Carolina, where I am a very proud public school elementary teacher. My name is Mrs. Turquoise Lejeune Parker, and I am so honored and truly hyped to be sharing with y'all today. Why? Because I get to talk about some of my favorite people and one of my favorite things. One of my favorite things is teaching, and some of my favorite people to teach is Mrs. Parker's professors. I believe wholeheartedly in putting some respect on folks' names. So we don't call them students, we call them professors, because we have to start celebrating, owning, and walking in our beauty, our intelligence, as early as possible. And why I love being a teacher is because we get a chance to foster this learning community that we call A Different World, because I'm sort of obsessed with the hit 90s TV show A Different World. But when you really think about it, learning, teaching, growing really is a different world. And I really love teaching, because this professors and I have fostered this learning community where we talk through very complex issues that prepare our mind, our body, for how we are going to take leadership, how we are going to defend and transform this world into what we all absolutely deserve. Teaching in the time of COVID, learning in the time of COVID, is something that we educators have always done and will always do. And that's making it happen for our schools, for our families, for our communities. But one thing that I hope that everyone hears me say today, and hears educators say from the past and from this moment on, is that educators, public school workers, always make it happen for our schools and our communities. Put some respect on that and funding on that.
Broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you cannot find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we're gonna walk it out. Silence is quiet, and it feels like it's getting so hard to breathe, and I know you feel like dying, but I promise we'll take the world to its feet. That we have each other, and for that we have each other, and we
Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you for having me. Peace and blessings, y'all.
Our teachers, our teachers, our teachers. We have just seen how America's educators are indeed America's heroes. They are the custodians not only of our children, but of our future, as they empower and inspire generations of students to achieve their potential. During past History Month for Women, Congress has gathered in the Capitol to honor trailblazing women, from Dolores Huerta to NASA's Hidden Figures to the women of the Supreme Court. And in 2016, we had the opportunity to celebrate with Dr. Biden and then First Lady Michelle Obama when we honored women veterans and the pioneering Air Force Brigadier General Wilma Vogt, godmother of the National Women in Military Service Memorial. This year, while we gather virtually, we proudly join Dr. Biden once again to build on this legacy of excellence as we honor the resilient spirit of America's educators, who inspire us with their creativity, compassion, and commitment to building a brighter future for children. When we ask to pay tribute to Dr. Biden, she said, only if we are honoring all of our educators. Hearing that, Dr. Biden, I recalled seeing you speak at NOVA in 2010 for the signing of the Healthcare and Education Reconciliation Act. It was clear then from the rapport between you and the students, the immense respect that you all had for each other. Dr. Biden, we are all in awe of your extraordinary advocacy for educators and grateful for the opportunity to join you in paying tribute to our heroes. Whether working in early childhood education, K through 12, higher education, or lifelong learning, our teachers have been dazzling, particularly throughout the pandemic. For over a year, they have been asked to do the impossible, using their ingenuity and imagination to develop innovative solutions to ensure that our children can continue to learn and grow. With the historic American Rescue Plan signed into law just last week by President Biden, Congress secured the resources to reopen schools safely, get vaccines in arms, and provide educators with the tools they need to empower students to thrive. We applaud the leadership of President Biden and Vice President Harris, the first woman vice president in American history, for putting us on the path to providing the first dose of the vaccine to millions of educators and childcare workers by the end of this month. This Congress has been blessed by the leadership and vision of more than 80 educators, including you, Congresswoman Johanna Hayes, the first former National Teacher of the Year to serve. These members bring their experience in the classroom to the critical work of the House to advance progress for the people, for the children. In closing, thank you all for joining us for this special celebration. Let us say thank you to today's artist, Andre Day, the Duke Ellington School of the Arts, and the Washington Performing Arts Children of the Gospel Choir for their beautiful music. Thank you also to the students of Benjamin Banneker Elementary School and educators Sarah Malanta Laffin, Turquoise Parker, Antoinette Albeta, and Jake, and Kate Sundin, for sharing your thoughts and moving us with your passion and brilliance. A special thank you to a lifelong educator and champion for our students, our new Secretary of Education, Miguel Cardona. And thank you especially to First Lady Jill Biden for making this a memorable Women's History Month celebration. Today and every day, we continue to fight for our educators' success, because when women succeed, America succeeds. Happy Women's History Month.